in contrast to the US reliance on bullets and bombs and proxy armies and fascist terror cells, Alex, China is asserting itself globally by building really important infrastructure. Why don't you tell us about that?
Yeah, so today was the Asia-Pacific Economic Cooperation Forum in Lima, Peru. You may have seen video of Xi Jinping stepping off of his plane to a red carpet and Joe Biden stepping off onto concrete. So Xi Jinping used the opportunity of this forum to inaugurate the construction of a $1.3 billion deep water port just north of Lima. This is a massive deal, and we're going to get into some of the juicy details of this. Here's the thing, and this is a money quote from the Atlantic Council, the Atlantic Council being the de facto think tank of NATO, and it's quoting the Financial Times journalist on the port who was there. Chinese made ZPMC unmanned cranes line the quay. BYD pickup trucks sit ready to shuttle engineers around, while Huawei 5G internet towers have been freshly constructed to handle the automated operation. This is back to the Atlantic Council. Mario de las Casas, a public affairs manager for the port for Costco Shipping, said Chinese state-owned company will operate Chang'an, that's the port, and said, everything is made in China. This is a huge opportunity, not just for Peru, but for the whole region. In contrast, Biden's trip comes at the, quote, tail end of 4 years marked by geopolitical conflicts in Europe and the Middle East, which steered his administration's foreign policy focus away from Latin America, writes the Atlantic Council's Martin Casalini and Caroline Castello. Biden will arrive in Lima and Rio with little of substance to offer. In January, Trump will begin his second term, determined to take a tougher approach to China, particularly when it comes to economic cooperation and trade. However, in Latin America and the Caribbean, with its 33 nations and 660 million people, he'll confront the reality that the United States has already lost much ground. As General Laura Richardson, then commander of the U.S. South Command, warned last year, China is, quote, on a 20-yard line in the red zone to our homeland. Trump's promise of higher tariffs and tougher immigration controls won't be the play to call. Won't be the play call to address that challenge. So what they're saying is that Biden just fucked off Latin America. Trump, his looming trade war with China, will not address the investment that China has made in Latin America. It will deal with bilateral relations rather than multilateral. And there's this Helsinki Times article which talks more about this project, located just about 80 kilometers north of Lima. Chang'an port is expected to reduce shipping times between South America and Asia annually, and the creation of 8,000 from 40 days to 23, with an economic impact projected at $4.5 billion annually in the creation of 8,000 jobs. Xi highlighted the port's regional importance, saying it will help build an Inca Trail in a new era with Chang'an port as its starting point, thus boosting the overall development and integration of the region. There's one more quote I wanted to pull from Xi. We should see to it that economic globalization generates more positive outcomes and is taken as a new phase that is more dynamic, inclusive, and sustainable, he said during his address. He also underscored the importance of collaboration, saying the Asia-Pacific miracle was built on openness and cooperation. We must continue to uphold these principles. Now, the Wall Street Journal has an excellent investigation, a real work of reporting, whether you agree with their slant or not. It's got a lot of very important information in it. And the article's called, this is just from a few days ago, How China Capitalized on U.S. Indifference in Latin America. And, well, we're having some issues moving the screen here, but give me a moment. Yeah, here we go. Chinese leader Xi Jinping arrives in the region where China has replaced the U.S. as the dominant trading partner for most big economies, with the exceptions of Mexico and Colombia. Beijing has signed up most of Latin America and the Caribbean to an infrastructure program that excludes the U.S. In Peru, Xi will inaugurate a megaport to speed trade with Asia. China is a voracious buyer of Argentinian lithium, crude oil from Venezuela, and Brazilian iron ore and soybeans. The $286.1 billion in Chinese projects in the region, tallied by Aid Data Research Lab at William & Mary in Williamsburg, Virginia, including metro lines in Bogota and Mexico City and hydroelectric dams in Ecuador, is approaching the value of China's work in Africa, but with a revamped lending model and less backlash. So what they're saying, because in Africa, Chinese investments were criticized as debt trap diplomacy. It was nothing compared to World Bank and IMF loans, but that was the criticism that the West chose. It doesn't pass with Latin America and their investments there. It appears that the lending terms are far more lenient. And I wanted to show this graph, largest extra-regional trading partners by total value of goods traded. This is 2000 on the left, the U.S. dominating the entire hemisphere. And on the right, 2023, China.
No.
Let's go further
well,
down.
Well, I mean, literally just as a brief interlude, I promise you, like it's the same thing plays out in mine and Alex's neck of the woods, which is the Balkans, right? So the Balkans has, because of the wars of the 90s and because of deliberate destruction of infrastructure by NATO across the region, they have been crying out for major infrastructure investment throughout the former Yugoslavia and also Albania, which is part of the same region, for a very long time. The EU and the US have provided nothing, right? Like absolutely nothing. So China comes along and builds high-speed rail in the region, and the US Western effort to counter this is not to, and they provide this on very favorable debt terms, mutual benefit. Like China benefits from having infrastructure in countries that allows it to take resources and goods out and put resources and goods in. Okay, so that's why they're doing this. And the the only response of Western powers is just to invest money in anti-Chinese propaganda. There is a website called Balkan Insight, which is effectively run by the CIA and MI6, which almost daily publishes negative stories about Chinese investment in the Balkans. They have this rather lavish interactive map, which shows you the progress of Chinese investment in the Balkans. They have a dedicated section which is front paged on China in the Balkans. Their attempt to win hearts and minds, the West's attempt to win hearts and minds in the West in the Balkans, isn't, well, let's try and compete with China and build decent, much needed infrastructure at competitive rates. It's let's use propaganda. That's the only response that they have to, Chinese quote unquote expansion globally, which is actually having a hugely positive effect for like local communities and the countries in which this is happening. Again, my interview with Ndongo, it is, if I do say so myself, it is fantastic. It touches on Chinese and Russian involvement and alliance with African countries. It is very clear that it is a very different model of international relations and international alliance that is being built and pursued by Beijing and Moscow to Washington and London and Paris and Brussels and Berlin and all of these old imperial powers. The project that Alex and I are focusing on now, there are no downsides to this. it would seem China's benefiting, Peru and the wider region is benefiting, and all the West can do is say, well, it's sinister because China is doing it.
Yeah.
But that's their only argument.
So I'm going to go ahead and play this video. Please interrupt it as much as you have something to say, because we want to give context to everything that's being put out here.
On South America's Pacific coast, a $3.5 billion megaport is putting Peru at the center of a growing rivalry between China and the U.S. When completed this fall, it'll be China's first deep water port in South America, promising shorter sailing times across the Pacific for critical exports like copper and iron ore. The U.S. is Latin America's top trade partner, but China is quickly gaining ground. And U.S. officials are worried this port will deepen China's influence in a region the U.S. has long considered its backyard. We'll break down the port's role in China's larger strategy in Latin America, and why some foreign policy experts consider it both a strategic and economic issue for the U.S. Located 50 miles north of Lima, the port of Chancay will be the first on South America's Pacific coast to receive megaships because of its nearly 60 feet of depth. Megaships will allow companies to send cargo directly between Peru and China instead of on smaller ships that have to go to Mexico or California first. This new route is expected to cut shipping times down by a third, according to China's Costco Shipping, the majority owner of the port.
The Chancay port is sort of emblematic of Belt and Road Initiative type projects, large-scale infrastructure projects that connect large agricultural producing regions, mining regions, to the coast.
The Peruvian port is funded by Chinese bank loans. Some construction began in 2016, but most of the development happened after Costco Shipping joined the project in 2019. Chinese President Xi Jinping plans to inaugurate the port in November when he visits South America for the first time since the pandemic.
The Chancay port, in my view, is one of these connectivity-enhancing projects tied most extensively to the exportation of commodities that China deems critically important.
Iron ore, for example, has helped fuel China's infrastructure boom at home and abroad. And copper, which is Peru's top export to China, is a critical component in electric vehicles. Chancay also serves as a gateway to new markets for China's EVs. Some foreign policy experts say Chancay is also well-positioned to transport lithium out of what's known as the Lithium Triangle, a region that holds roughly 60% of the world's largely untapped lithium resources. Another big focus for China is getting better access to soybeans from Brazil. Right now, most Brazilian exports have to go east via the Atlantic. Chancay presents an alternative route, but getting goods from Brazil to the other side of the Amazon rainforest and Andean mountains is a major challenge.
When you look at a map of South America, you see a very clear effort to develop a network equipped to bring key commodities to port in an efficient and ideally cost-effective manner.
Former U.S. officials say Chancay highlights a diplomatic void that the U.S. has left in Latin America, partly because it's a complicated place to do business.
President Pedro Castillo has been arrested on charges of rebellion and conspiracy after being ousted by Congress.
This is a country that has had about a president a year for the last 6 years or so, and that affects certain types of investment.
Meanwhile, China has stepped up its investment in Latin America.
When Peruvian business people go to the U.S., they often get the sense that U.S. business interests aren't as interested in Latin America, particularly not in issues of infrastructure, and the Chinese are.
Some foreign policy experts say investing in infrastructure projects abroad gives China diplomatic leverage, which it could exploit if needed.
Just to point out, that's like the fifth time that they've cited some foreign policy experts.
Yes. Some people might say, yeah. I mean, but this is the thing as well, is that like I mean there is that well-worn phrase by now that like every accusation is a confession. And it's just like, I mean, let's imagine that what they're saying is true, that like evil, dastardly China is building all of this stuff purely for cynical, hard-nosed realpolitik reasons. I mean, they're still doing a hell of a lot more than the US is. Like, I mean, just on a basic level. And it's like, you know, a classic example that I always, I mentioned Balkan Insight, right? There was an astonishing article that they published kind of mid-2021, which was called Chinese Debt Trap Diplomacy in the Balkans, which, as Alex said, quite correctly. It's not a thing. It doesn't exist, right? So there is an article. This article basically tries to identify Chinese debt trap diplomacy in the Balkans, and it can't, apart from naming some really valuable and worthwhile investments in rail infrastructure and road infrastructure in the Balkans. And then it has a whole excerpt about how in Albania, and I've lived in Albania for a period, a very beautiful country with zero transport infrastructure whatsoever, they had to shut down their train system, their national train system, if you could even call it that, which is about as slow as walking in 2022. You can find videos on the internet of people taking this, Western tourists taking this train, which is has no lights, is smashed up, coated in graffiti, non-functioning toilets, and is very, very slow. When they shut it down, the Albanian government, the Chinese tried to step in to fund the construction of new railways in Albania, and the Albanian government basically just harassed them out of town and told them to F off. And there is an Albanian academic quoted in the article saying, this was insane, we needed the money. Right? Like, you know, and it's just like, yeah, all of this stuff is being built up is like hugely sinister, when in reality, these countries are crying out for investment. Walter Rodney had a book called How the West Underdeveloped Africa. And it's the same elsewhere, that like in so many places and cases, China is building infrastructure in countries where the West has specifically refused to do so in order to immiserate and impoverish the local population. Like, you know, it's deliberately attempting to create forced dependency and prevent countries from making their own products or having sovereignty in any field, and mainly being exporters of raw resources and importers of Western goods. Like, that's the US imperialist global model, and it's being undermined by China, like, actually positively helping countries. I mean, this will be a huge game changer for Peru and the wider region. It's quite astonishing. And like, it is a completely new trade route that is being built. We must ask ourselves why this is completely new. Well, the US didn't want it.
Yeah. So I mean, you have China offering roads, bridges, telecommunication towers, hydroelectric dams, deep sea ports, and the US is offering missiles, drag shows, and regime change.
No. I mean, I'm certainly not suggesting.
Go ahead.
Oh no, I'm not open to the offer of missiles and drag shows. But on like a practical level, it does seem more useful.
Are concerned to the U.S., meaning the ports and the equipment in them can have both commercial and military uses.
China's access and exclusive access to a deep water port allows access to sensitive information about the coming and going of goods that can be utilized for various purposes or in some cases potentially disrupted.
COSCO, the Chinese port operator, says Chunghai is purely intended to boost commerce. Peru has also brushed off U.S. concerns, since the Peruvian government would have to approve the arrival of foreign military. But there have been other Chinese port development projects that have led U.S. officials to question China's intent.
Some of these investments have very little commercial rationale. And one example is the La Union project in El Salvador. This is a port that has been rendered inoperable because of the extensive dredging required to make it functional. And yet this was something that the Chinese companies expressed extensive interest in doing at the time that El Salvador decided to cut ties with Taiwan and establish them with mainland China.
That port expansion project was ultimately blocked by a series of political and legal obstacles in El Salvador.
They're going to do it in Nicaragua instead.
For Peru, Chunghai is part of a broader plan to strengthen its role as a trading and economic hub with Asia. The current shipping route from Peru is too long for most perishable foods to get to China. Chunghai will make it easier for produce like blueberries and avocados to reach Asian markets.
the local people in Chiang Kai and the near north of Lima also have a lot of expectations that this will generate employment, local investment, better services, community development as well.
But the port faces a big problem, a lack of roads.
The Pan American Highway going north is our largest north and south access route, and it's the main route to the port. Peru is going to have to build or expand access routes so that trucks with containers and products can come back and forth. It's a very dense, highly trafficked highway already.
Another potential challenge for Chiang Kai is that China hasn't always lived up to its promises when it comes to infrastructure development in Latin America.
Coquecoto Sinclair, the dam in Ecuador, is the best example of this. There were a lot of concerns about labor, the quality of construction. The dam has numerous cracks. It's also underperforming. It's not generating as much electricity as had been promised.
Sinohydro Corporation didn't respond to requests for comment.
Part of the challenges of working in Latin America is precisely the inefficiency of our authorities. And the Chinese have come late to the region compared to Western investors, and they've had a very steep learning curve.
The Chiang Kai port has already run into problems during construction. Two workers died this year in accidents at the port. The company says it is investigating the circumstances.
Did you hear that? Two workers died during construction of the port. Check this out. 5,609 killed during the construction of the Panama Canal. So, I mean, this is what they have to say. They say, oh, well, there's environmental destruction, as if, you know, the U.S. has ever cared about business interests destroying the environment in Latin America or workers being killed on the job, you know. You have to imagine, I mean, and meanwhile, bridges in the U.S. are collapsing and killing people seemingly every other month now. So
yeah,
I just wanted to play a bit of that,
Alex, but
right. I just wanted to play a bit of that because I thought it was very informative on the scale of this announcement. And, you know, in typical U.S. fashion, they have a response to it, which I'm just going to play and then we'll move on. Assuming you don't have anything to add more to add, but this is the US response.
Wrap up, Alex. You go for it.
Sure.
Well, this is an exciting day in our partnership. The United States will support the city of Lima as it develops a new passenger train line that's going to connect downtown.
They've donated a train. That's the response. They've donated a train to China's, you know, what is it? $1.3 billion deep water port. So yeah, guys, we're running low on time. We had some other stuff that we wanted to get to. We didn't make it. But we really appreciate everyone joining us. Are you good? We're wrapping up. Okay.
Yeah, I mean, my internet appears to have taken a shit and died. I think that's we're nearing 2 hours, so a good time to wrap up. But I mean, I do think that there we see, despite all of the propaganda and all of the framing and all of the terrifying rhetoric, China is building. Other countries are building. We are living in a new world where, the US is not the only sheriff in town. That is having a positive impact all over the global South. And with any luck, that positive impact will reverberate home in due course.
Hey, everyone. If you enjoyed this video or any of our other content, please give us a follow on Twitter or subscribe to us on YouTube. It'll help us beat the algorithm oligarchs. Thank you.